Well, hey guys, in today's video, I'm gonna be talking all about your skin microbiome, why it's important, and what you might be doing that's messing it up and causing problems like irritation, acne breakouts, dry skin, etc. Most people are familiar with the idea that our gut is colonized with bacteria that help keep us healthy, and we're learning a lot of new things about it, including that consumption of fiber, aka prebiotics, is really important in facilitating those good, healthy gut microbes that can help in calming down total body inflammation and play a key role in a variety of disease processes. Today's video is in partnership with Olipop. You guys know I'm not really a soda drinker, but I love different sodas from my childhood. Like, I used to be a huge Diet Coke drinker and I always enjoyed root beer, but Olipop is all those great flavors, but it doesn't have that level of sugar that a typical soda does. Click the link in my description box and you can get 20% off. I know you guys are gonna love these. They are amazing. I'm having the orange squeeze right now and it's like slice, orange slice. You guys remember that? Yeah, it's really good. But it's not just our gut that's colonized by different microbes that play a key role in keeping us healthy. Our skin is as well. There are actually anywhere from 10,000 to a million microbes per centimeter square of your skin. I know that sounds really freaky, but they actually are really important in keeping your skin barrier healthy and protecting you from the outside world. Everybody is unique in terms of the different types of bacteria that make up their skin microbiome. Things like Staphylococcal bacterium and Cutibacterium are key players, but there are different bacteria and different overall abundance, diversity. These microbes also prevent bad bacteria from causing problems on our skin, and they also help with the local skin immune system. The diversity and type of bacteria varies from body site. So for example, the microbiome in your armpit is a lot different than the microbiome on your face. And it also differs a lot from person to person. Interestingly enough, if you cohabitate with somebody and share like the same bed, and you're in close proximity, you have skin-on-skin contact, that can actually start to influence your microbiome. But it's not just bacteria. There are yeast that are symbiotic on our skin and play a role in balancing out inflammation. Also, parasites. I know, it sounds horrifying. But the little parasite Demodex is a key player in our local microbiome. I have a video all about Demodex, these little eyelash mites. They're as terrifying as they look and sound, they're actually helpful in the health of our skin. Unfortunately though, our local skin microbiome can become disrupted, just like our gut microbiome can become disrupted, and that can lead to different disease states. Just like in the case of our gut, you know, a disrupted gut microbiome is linked with things like irritable bowel syndrome, inflammatory bowel disease, inflammation in the body, arthritis, poor cognitive function. All of these things we're learning are linked to our gut microbiome. But likewise, skin problems can be due to disruption in the skin microbiome. And when the skin microbiome is disrupted, that local bacterial constitution is no longer as effective at helping the skin act as a barrier. And as a result, you have an increase in inflammation. You're more susceptible to skin infections and skin diseases. Things like acne and eczema have been tightly linked to disruptions in the skin microbiome. It's an area of active research, but we're really learning a lot about how the bacteria on our skin really keep us healthy. So now that you're aware that your local skin microbiome is key to keeping your skin healthy, what can you do to cultivate your skin microbiome to support overall better skin health and skin barrier function? And I emphasize your, because again, we all have a different makeup of bacteria and microorganisms on our skin, and it's going to vary from person to person. Also, it varies from environment to environment. If you live in a drier climate or a more humid climate, these things are all going to be different. But one thing I would emphasize to you all that can really mess up your skin microbiome is over-aggressive hygiene practices. Over-washing the face strips the skin of its natural bacteria. Now those will then, you know, come back. It's not as though, you know, you've wiped everything out. But over time, that can begin to facilitate those bad bacteria coming in and causing problems like flares of acne, eczema, maybe even rosacea. Over-cleansing also messes up the pH of your skin, and this can impact what microorganisms are able to live on your skin and ultimately end up skewing your microbiome to more pathogenic organisms. Our skin also has these little compounds called antimicrobial peptides, and when you wash your face too frequently or wash your skin too frequently, you over-cleanse, you start removing those antimicrobial peptides. Those antimicrobial peptides, they play a key role in reducing inflammation in the skin, and they're tightly linked to the disease process of rosacea. Part of rosacea is inflammation, and it's linked to certain antimicrobial peptides in the skin and problems with the antimicrobial peptide levels. The second thing you might be doing is over-exfoliating. Over-exfoliating with time can really skew your microbiome towards more pathogenic organisms, because again, you are not only removing the lipids, but you are then disrupting the natural pH of the skin barrier, and that can then skew the levels of these good bacteria in favor of the bad bacteria. Taking long hot showers or using antibacterial wipes, antibacterial hand soaps is another thing that can disrupt your skin barrier. Now we're all super aware of how important hand washing is, but you don't necessarily need to be using an antibacterial soap. These are really popular, but actually the studies show that simply washing with plain soap and water the hands for 20 seconds does just as good a job as using an antibacterial soap. But unfortunately, the antibacterial soaps, they might actually end up messing up the skin microbiome on your hands, ultimately causing skin problems like hand eczemas and or make you more at risk for skin infection. So just plain soap and water is a better choice than maybe an antibacterial hand soap. Those are just some skincare practices that you might want to modify to overall support your skin microbiome better. But our microflora is a lot more than just these little organisms. You have prebiotics, which are the food or the fertilizer for your good bacteria. Prebiotics are important not only for your skin microbiome, but also for your gut. And getting prebiotics in your diet has been linked to improvement in the gut microbiome and improvement in various disease states. And we have learned in recent years how important this is to human health. Olipop sparkling tonics are a really fun way to get these prebiotics into your diet. They're so important for feeding the good bacteria in your gut. Did you know that 95% of American adults don't get enough fiber? But with just one can of Olipop, you get 1/3 of your daily recommended value. Unfortunately, 53% of Americans do exceed the daily recommended intake of sugar. Olipop drinks are all under 5 grams of sugar, so it's a modern take on nostalgia, like a trip down memory lane, but Olipop is re-engineered soda to remove all of that unnecessary excessive sugar with actual functional healthy ingredients that are good for your gut. Olipop is vegan, gluten-free, and paleo-friendly with less than 50 calories per can. But the taste is almost too good to be true. They taste exactly like the real thing. The flavors are amazing. Cherry vanilla, vintage cola. There's also a ginger lemon one that is delicious. And my favorite is the classic root beer. As a matter of fact, did you guys know that A&W root beer has like 45 grams of sugar? Wow. I also adore the strawberry vanilla flavor, but all of the flavors are amazing. Don't just take my word for it. Click the link in my description box and you can get 20% off plus free shipping on the Variety 12 pack. You guys are really gonna love these. So it's prebiotics that are what is really important for the good bacteria. They need that as their food to thrive off of. And then you have probiotics. Probiotics are live microorganisms that can help in encouraging the good bacteria to grow. Really popular in things like kimchi and kefir, these probiotic rich foods. But to be honest, it's really hard, almost impossible, to formulate skincare products with live bacteria. I mean, where do you begin? Skincare products have to be shelf stable. They have preservatives in them. How do you keep a skincare product safe with live bacteria in it without without bad bacteria taking over in a tube or a bottle? How do you do that? The technology's not there. And importantly, what bacteria do you include? We really don't know. As I said at the intro, everyone's skin microbiome is different, has different needs. And some people have skin conditions that maybe would benefit from certain bacteria over others, whereas other people who don't have those skin conditions might not need those. It may be unnecessary, and maybe it's even harmful to them. Those are things we don't know, and we really don't even know how to properly formulate probiotics into skincare products. Then there's something else called postbiotics. You also have something called postbiotics that you might not have heard of. Postbiotics are chemicals or metabolic byproducts of the good bacteria, and they actually do a lot of stuff themselves. Things like reduce inflammation, irritation, help with skin pH and skin barrier function. So prebiotics, probiotics, and postbiotics, they're all really important factors in both your skin microbiome and your gut microbiome. But getting these guys all together in a cream or formulation to actually go on your skin, the details of that have not been worked out. Now, things like thermal spring water are rich actually in prebiotics. And there is some evidence that thermal spring water is helpful for inflammatory skin conditions like eczema. There's like a big center in France where they treat people with eczema and also some people with psoriasis as well with thermal spring water. And there's some thought that maybe it's the prebiotics in the thermal spring water that helps with skin barrier recovery. But even that is really an area where we don't know a whole lot and we don't know the full answer. And again, that's in specific skin conditions, inflammatory skin conditions. So to what extent that ends up being useful for people, it's hard to say. But Avène and La Roche-Posay skincare products, they all have those thermal spring waters. So if you're using those products, you know, that's something that might be actually what is helpful in those products is those prebiotics, but we really don't know for sure. One day, maybe we'll have skincare that is tailored to our unique microbiome and our unique needs. For example, Bifidobacterium longum. I had to write these names down because I would not remember them. This is a bacteria that has been shown to increase the skin's resistance to irritation, either from products or extremes of temperature. So maybe in the future, one day we'll see a cream that is reparative that has this in it, this bacteria in it. But I don't know how they would formulate that. Streptococcus thermophilus. Now, this is a bacteria that helps or has been shown to help in increasing the production of ceramides in the skin, which are important for barrier function. So that might end up being important in skincare products tailored to people who have things like eczema or irritant contact dermatitis and need skin barrier repair. Lactobacillus paracasei is a bacteria that has been shown to inhibit the neuropeptide substance P, which plays a role in inflammation and irritation. So you can see how we've really just begun to scratch the surface of understanding how these different bacteria and microbes and prebiotics and postbiotics facilitate our skin health. And it's very obvious that it's very individualized. So what one person needs at one point in their life is going to be very different from what another person needs. And again, these things probably change. They're dependent on body site. They're dependent on your environment and perhaps as well who you're cohabitating with. In the meantime, I recommend being really mindful of your hygiene, not going overboard. In the case of your face, this is why I always emphasize that you don't want to be over cleansing. Not only does it strip your natural lipid barrier and lead to increase in transepidermal water loss and dryness, it also impacts the skin microbiome and can influence your susceptibility to irritation, inflammation, and pathogenic organisms that cause skin problems. The other thing is to put the brakes on over-exfoliating. I have a video on how to exfoliate and the benefits of exfoliating. And as I've said in that video and other videos, you certainly can overdo it with the exfoliation. And a lot of people end up doing that and causing skin problems, and one underlying component of that is disruption to the skin microbiome. Moisturizing consistently is also really important. This helps with skin pH and skin barrier function. I recommend selecting a bland moisturizer, and by bland, I mean free of fragrance and common irritating ingredients. Try and choose a moisturizer that has a short ingredient list. I have videos on moisturizer recommendations, so definitely check those out if you are in the market for a moisturizer, but stick to simple products. And lastly, it's really important that you avoid unnecessary use of topical antibiotics, antibacterial wipes, antibacterial hand soaps. Now, obviously, there are skin conditions that are treated with topical antibiotics. Always, of course, follow the recommendations of your treating healthcare provider and use those as directed. But don't self-treat with topical antibiotics, either old topical antibiotics that may be left over from a prior prescription or those that you buy in the store. Things like Neosporin, not only do those cause contact dermatitis, but you can really be mucking up your local skin microbiome. And truthfully, those over-the-counter antibiotics, they're really not very good at even killing the bad bacteria. So minimize the use of those things. But at this point, the science is not there yet as far as prebiotics and probiotics and postbiotics and your skincare. But we do have a lot of research highly supporting how important prebiotics are in your diet and in your gut health and how that influences various disease states. So if you guys are in the market for a sweet prebiotic treat, definitely check out Olipop. And again, check out the link in my description box. You can save 20% off their variety pack plus free shipping. Thank you, Olipop, for sponsoring a portion of today's video. I hope you guys enjoyed it. If so, give it a thumbs up, share it with your friends. And as always, don't forget sunscreen and subscribe. I'll talk to you guys tomorrow. Bye.